Greetings. I've been giving a topic a lot of thought lately, and I have been considering facts from several directions. This video is not intended to discourage. It is intended to shine the light on Satan's perfect scheme. By understanding Satan's scheme, I hope you will be prepared. Most people hear the word Islam and they think, a religion. But the real imposition of Islam is Sharia law. And it is Sharia law that is Satan's stroke of brilliance. Allow me to step back a few paces and briefly lay a foundation for this presentation. Yahweh God sent the prophets. I have a video series detailing seven key high points of their message. If you have not watched them, I'll include links to them in the next few slides. The Message of the Prophets, Part 1. Part 2, Redeemer. Part 3, Redemption Fulfilled. Part 4, God in the Earth. Part 5, God comes to His temple. Part 6, God's proper name. Part 7, Thy Holy City. When Messiah, the Son of God, died on the cross, God's plan to provide salvation was complete. After that, Satan schemed for 600 years, and Satan is the best deceiver, the Al-Makr. Satan appeared to an unlearned, ignorant man as an angel of light. Satan convinced this unlearned, ignorant man that Satan was Allah, the Lord of the worlds. And over a period of 23 years, Satan spun a web of lies and a set of rules that are called Sharia. If you do not know Sharia, you don't know Islam's plan. Before you hear the details of Sharia, perhaps you should understand Satan's goal. Satan's goal is not just to kill you. Satan's goal is to condemn you to hell. If Satan simply kills you, he loses. If you follow the Son of God, death and the grave has no sting. So it is not in Satan's interest to kill you quickly. And as you will realize, Sharia, Satan's scheme, is not designed to kill you quickly. Let's take a look at Sharia, which Muslims want to impose all over the world. I give full credit to Dr. Bill Warner for his research. Dr. Bill Warner has a channel called Political Islam. And he has a series of books summarizing Islam and the Quran. Let's take a look at Sharia, how it discriminates against Christians to try and crush the Christianity out of them. The rule for dhimmis, meaning Christians subjugated under Sharia law, established in the Treaty of Umar. We, all the references to we, are the Christians' commitment. We shall not build in our cities or in their neighborhood new monasteries, churches, convents, or monks' cells. Nor shall we repair, by day or by night, such of them as fall in ruins or are situated in the quarters of the Muslims. The implication and goal of this is to, over time, simply destroy every Christian facility through compelled neglect. The Kingdom of Darkness of Saudi Arabia does not allow churches to be built. We shall keep our gates wide open for passers-by and travelers. We shall give board and lodging to all Muslims who pass our way for 3 days. You will be required to keep your doors unlocked, and you must give food and a bed to any and every Muslim who demands it for up to 3 days. We shall not give shelter in our churches or in our dwellings to any spy, nor hide him from the Muslims. We shall not manifest our religion publicly, nor convert anyone to it. We shall not prevent any of our kin from entering Islam if they wish it. This is the one-way trapdoor to hell. Freedom of religion under Sharia is outlawed. You shall show respect toward the Muslims, and we shall rise from our seats when they wish to sit. This should ring alarm bells in your head, clanging to remind you how blacks were treated in America. If you are a black Christian, you really should be afraid of this evil Obama has been importing into your nation. We shall not seek to resemble the Muslims by imitating any of their garments. So if you think you'll just pass as Mohammedan in a man dress, that will be a crime. We shall not mount on saddles, nor shall we gird swords, nor bear any kind of arms, nor carry them on our persons. Please understand, this is what the Muslims in America really want. This is why Islam and Sharia is not compatible with democracy or the American Constitution. Sharia will outlaw your Second Amendment rights and any right to self-defense against a Mohammedan. We shall not engrave Arabic inscriptions on our seals. Another segregation, another demarcation to prove you are not of Satan's cult. We shall not sell fermented drinks, meaning alcohol. You will find Mohammedans burning vineyards and destroying all breweries. We shall clip the fronts of our heads, keep a short forelock as a sign of humiliation. Can it be any clearer? Sharia is designed to humiliate Christians, and through lifetimes of humiliation, drive Christians to Islam to escape the humiliation and torture. And doing so, Satan damns you to hell with him. We shall dress in the same way wherever we may be, and we shall bind the zunar around our waists. Christians and Jews had to wear special clothing. Think about the yellow stars Jews had to wear under the Nazis. We shall not display our crosses or our books in the roads or markets of the Muslims. We shall only use clappers in our churches very softly. We shall not raise our voices when following our dead. No loud crying is allowed for non-Muslims. We shall not take slaves who have been allotted to Muslims. Oh, did you know slavery is still legal in Islam? Except only Muslims get to own them, and your daughter may be one of the slaves. We shall not build houses higher than the houses of the Muslims. Every aspect of Christian life must be subjugated and subordinated to Mohammedans. Humiliation and degradation in every area of life, to torture you and drive you to Islam. Whoever strikes a Muslim with deliberate intent shall forfeit the protection of this pact. Defending yourself in any way will not be tolerated if you are a dhimmi or kafir under Sharia law. That all comes from Al-Tirtushi, Siraj al-Muluk, page 229 to 230. Again, kudos and thanks to Dr. Bill Warner, Political Islam, for his thorough, unbiased research and books. Quoting, "In addition, the dhimmi could not testify in Sharia court and therefore had no legal recourse in an argument with a Muslim. A dhimmi could not criticize Muhammad or speak with a Muslim about Christianity." This is from A Taste of Islam series, Sharia Law for Non-Muslims, page 30 to 31, Dr. Bill Warner, Political Islam. Now, some may think I'm taking this to the extreme and ascribing evil intent which Muslims today do not have. Just so you know, that is not the case. I'm including a video of a Mohammedan in Britain, I believe, saying just these things. The following is included under fair use for teaching purposes.
Rasulullah said, "Don't greet the Jews and the Christians before they greet you, and when you meet any of them on the roads, force them to go on the narrow side of it." And Imam Maliki said the same thing. In his charter was, Kafir and Muslim, they're not allowed to wear the same clothes as one another. If the Muslim, he comes out on the day of Eid and he sees Kafir with nice clothes, the Kafir has to take his clothes off and give it to the Muslims. The Kafir, when he walks inside the street, he has to wear a red belt around his neck and he has to have his forehead shaved and he has to wear two shoes which are different from one another. He's not allowed to walk on the pavement. He has to walk in the middle of the road and he has to ride on a mule. And that's only for the adults, not for the children. And you can see how Islam would make the child become a Muslim. The kafir, or the child growing up in a state of kufr, he will turn to Islam. Why? Because the child will be walking along with his dad. He said, Dad, yeah? Why you got your forehead shaved? I don't know whether these Muslims, they make me do it. Why you got to walk? Why can't you ride the animal? Like the Muslims, they walk like, ride the animal like this. Why are you walking with both legs dangling on the side of the donkey? Why is it every time the Muslim comes to you, he asks you for your clothes, you give it? Why is it every time he tells you to get down from the horse, you have to take it? And not only that, he said the kuffar, they can have their churches. They can have their churches, but they're not allowed to ring the bell. And if a Muslim, he's walking by, let's say, for example, a Muslim's been on Edgeway Road, for example. He's had some nice shisha, some nice steak, no hubble bubble, we don't deal with anything like that. And he's walking along and he's rubbing his belly and he's like, oh man, you know, I don't want to upset my wife tonight. What he can do, he can go to the church, knock on the door, John, let me in. Okay, no problem. John has to put up Abdul Ghafoor for the night. Abdul Ghafoor with his big belly, having his nice kebab, John has to open up the church and he has to go there and sleep there nice and comfortable and say, all right, John, thank you, and then carry on going early in the morning. Which wife is going to live with John under that type of circumstances? What kind of honoring is this for me to live with John and Abdul Ghafoor comes every Friday night and sleeps in our bed as well? Of course. Because sunnah is to look after the guest, isn't it? I can't make you sleep on my floor if you can't. And you're Muslim, by the way. So what about when Abdul Ghafoor goes to John's house? John, sleep on the floor, and I'll sleep on the bed. What's going to happen? Tracy's going to be on the floor thinking, my husband, he's got a forehead shaved, and this one, look to this one, Khatab, mashallah. Which one's more attractive? We're not gay, but I'm just saying. A man with his forehead shaved, and one belt around his neck, and two different colored shoes, or Amir Khatab. Amir Khatab, we're talking about here now, with that nice Chechen hat, big beard, you know, a bit to the side. Yeah, and he's got the badges there, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. Yeah, and he's got a big gun, and he's got a big camouflage jacket on, nice boots, gloves as well. Even if he's got a couple of fingers missing, still looks attractive. Yeah, what's Tracy gonna do? John's in for a problem. He just let him in for a kebab, he lost his own wife as well. So everyone's going to become Muslim. That is, my dear brothers, the Islamic State.
Understand that even now, some liberal judges are basing law upon Sharia concepts. Sharia is evil and is Satan's master plan to drag Christians to hell if he can. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.